Hi, I'm Kate, physiotherapist, and welcome to my channel. Did you know that 85% of Americans have experienced or will experience a low back pain in their lives? Back pain costs United States $78 billion a year. One of the main causes of low back pain is lumbar disc herniation, and today I will tell you a few things about it. We've all heard of discopathy, but many of us don't know how or why it happens. Many patients believe that disc lesion occurs when the pain occurs. Most often we bend down to pick up some object, to tie a shoe, and suddenly we are pierced by sharp pain. We can't get up and we need to see a doctor or a physical therapist. But the truth is, most disc lesions occur months or even years before this happens. To understand it well, we need to look deep into our body and understand how our spine is built. Our spine is composed of bone structures called vertebrae, and these are these white ones. Also, we have intervertebral discs, so these are the green ones, which, as you can see, lie between the bones. These yellow wires that stick out here are the nerves, which are giving us the information from our brain to the tissues. You can't see that on this model, but our spine is surrounded by numerous ligaments. Ligaments on the one hand allow movement, but on the other hand limit it and stabilize the spine. Of course, in addition, our spine is surrounded by muscles, which allow movement, but also stabilize the entire column of the spine. So our spine is an extremely durable structure that allows us to move, jump, run, and carry heavy loads. So how does such a strong structure get damaged? Well, there are studies that show genetic basis of discopathy. But when we think about it, what isn't genetically determined, right? Nearly everything is. And since we have no influence on the genes, at least for now, we will not deal with this topic today. But there are also other conditions that contribute to disc degeneration and which we can control. These include obesity, smoking, low levels of physical activity, prolonged sitting, and today, yes, let's focus on prolonged sitting. If we look at the structure of the intervertebral disc itself, it comes out that it is not a homogeneous structure. If we pulled out this disc, which is not possible in the real life, this disc consists of two structures. Inside the disc is a jelly-like substance called nucleus pulposus. Around it is an annulus fibrosus that surrounds the nucleus. As I have already told you, it is not possible to remove the disc like that. So the statement often used by patients that discs slip is a simplification. The disc cannot slip because it is connected to the vertebra above and below by a so-called end plate. End plate is a very, very strong connection that keeps the intervertebral disc in the line with vertebral bodies. So then what do we see on MRI? After all, we see something that is clearly sticking out here. However, it is not the entire intervertebral disc that has moved, has slipped, but only its content that bulges. Therefore, this slipping disc is not entirely appropriate name to use. So here we have an intervertebral disc, and inside this disc we have a nucleus pulposus. Nucleus pulposus is a structure that works on hydraulic principle. When we link our trunk forward, the front parts of the vertebral bodies will come closer together and the back parts will move away, giving the space for the nucleus pulposus to move backwards, to move this direction. And when we lean back, the opposite situation will occur. The back parts of the vertebral bodies will come closer together and the front parts will move away, giving a nucleus pulposus a place to go to the abdominal part. And all of this works fine when the annulus fibrosus surrounding the nucleus is healthy, but unfortunately it can get damaged. So if we look deeper into the structure of annulus fibrosus, it turns out it has a layered structure. It consists of about 20 layers with properly arranged collagen fibers. The arrangement of individual collagen fibers in the layers of annulus fibrosus is alternating. This means that one layer has collagen fibers in one direction and the next layer has collagen fibers in opposite direction, and so on and so on and so on. And as you remember, we got around 20 layers like that. Such an arrangement of collagen fibers means that on the one hand it allows some rotational movements, but on the other hand limits them. but more on that soon. And moreover, you can see that on this picture, the individual layers of the annulus fibrosus do not have a constant thickness. They are wider in the front, abdominal part, and narrower in the back, dorsal part. And I am telling you all of this for a reason, because all of this will have an impact on the disc damage mechanism. Additionally, we need to know that only about 1/3 of the outer layers of the annulus fibrosus are innervated. The remaining 2/3 of the inner layers of the annulus do not have the nerve endings. And now, how does disc damage while sitting? Theoretically, it is possible to sit in a proper, correct position in which our intervertebral discs will not be overloaded and with maintaining the correct curvature of the lumbar spine. However, sitting like that requires a lot of work of our core muscles. And our muscles are, unfortunately, lazy. And whenever they have an option not to work, they don't. So while sitting, we assume a hunched position in the shape of the letter C. Like that. At this point, our muscles don't need to be tense, don't have to work, and our body weight hangs on the structures of the spine. So we start to overload our ligaments, our vertebrae, and our intervertebral discs. While sitting, we also increase the loading on the intervertebral discs, and it has been clinically proven many times. Famous studies on disc pressure measurements is showing how much sitting and bending forward overloads our lumbar spine. As you can see, sitting, bending, and lifting loads increase the load on our lumbar spine dramatically. So when we look at this banana-shaped sitting, we can easily assume that when we sit like that, our ligaments on the back side of our spine are stretched to maximum. Imagine this is a ligament. When our lumbar spine is in a correct position, in a correct lordotic position, then the ligament is properly tensed. But when we flex our body, when we lean the trunk and do like that, you can easily imagine that this ligament had to stretch to the maximum. And if this situation is short and we go back, nothing will happen. However, if we sit in this position for a prolonged period of time, for several hours a day without a break, then this ligament, which goes in the back of our spine, these ligaments will remain loose. And when we go back, as you can see here, it will give a greater possibility of movement towards the back. Of course, it doesn't look like that. I am exaggerating, so you can easily understand the mechanism. As you already know, when bending forward, we push the nucleus backward. We have a greater ability to move backwards because our ligaments on the back side of our spine are stretched and this disc is being degenerated. And now let's see what is happening in the intervertebral disc itself. And we have several stages of disc degeneration. It begins with so-called bulging, which can be compared to swelling. It is a condition that can be reversed quickly and leaves no permanent damage. However, if we don't change our postural habits and continue to overload this tissue, the further damage will occur. What is damaged first is the innermost layers of the annulus fibrosus. Over time, more and more layers of annulus fibrosus degenerate. As you remember, I told you that only the outer layers of the annulus fibrosus are innervated, and that is why we don't feel the first stages of disc lesion, because we can't simply feel them. We start to feel it when outer layers of the annulus fibrosus are degraded. So first stages of disc degeneration are asymptomatic and it can last months or even years. The extremely important question is why the damage occurs usually when we bend our spine and rotate it. An example of such movement is tying shoes or vacuuming. So we need to bend and rotate our body, and usually in this position we start feeling the pain. We have already explained a bending mechanism a bit. When we bend our torso, the disc moves backwards. It has the space to do so because we stretched our ligaments, we have instability in our spine, but an additional factor here is the structure of the annulus layers in the back part. The layers of the annulus fibrosus are thicker in the abdominal part and much thinner, much narrower in the back part of our spine. And that is why they will tear more easily here. I told you about the flexion, and now let's think about rotation. Why rotation? We need to know that natural range of rotation is very big in cervical spine. We can rotate our head, right? It's very big also in the thoracic spine. But when we go lower, the range of motion of rotation decreases. And when we speak about lumbar spine, it has the lowest range of motion of rotational movements in the whole spine. So we can say that naturally our lumbar spine doesn't like to rotate. But there is one more thing. When we return to the scheme of the collagen fibers that we have in our annulus fibrosus, everything becomes clear. Let's say that out of 20 layers of the annulus fibrosus, 6 internal ones are damaged. 20 minus 6, it's 14. So we have 14 healthy ones left. You remember this, collagen fibers. Out of these 14, only half of them protects the movement, rotational movements to one side, and half of them protects the rotational movements towards the other side. So technically speaking, we have 14 layers of annulus fibrosus still left, still healthy, but only 7 are protecting the rotational movements towards one side. And this is why this rotational mechanism is so common in these herniations. It is simply the movement that is least secure in our lumbar spine. Okay, so what to do? If you have a damaged disc, does it always mean the pain? Surprisingly not. Studies have shown that most of us, sooner or later, in our MRI scans will have herniated discs. And many of us will never even know about it. However, if you already have a disc herniation that is giving symptoms, the treatment is of course necessary. Depending on how badly the intervertebral disc has been damaged, various forms of treatment are used. In many cases, when the outermost layers of the annulus fibrosus have not been damaged, we have a chance to completely withdraw the symptoms with appropriate techniques and exercises. In some cases, of course, you will need a surgery. So your doctor and your physical therapist will tell you about the possible treatment. And what about sitting? Since we already know that this is conducive to the formation of lumbar discopathy, we should make sure to sit correctly. Now we know that what overloads our lumbar region the most is flexion and rotation. So this gentleman in this photo is sitting in the worst possible position. He bends the lumbar spine by slouching and forces the pelvis to rotate by crossing one leg over the other. So this is not the way we should be sitting. In order to sit properly, we should maintain a neutral curvature of the lumbar spine. We can protect our lumbar spine with some correctors applied to the chair or simply through a well-contoured office chair. There are also chairs or seats that are forcing your pelvis to stay tilted forward and correct your lumbar spine position. But this is only a little help, and we should not expect that to solve the problem. Our spine needs to move, and the most important thing is to take breaks while sitting and change your position during this time. Preferably walk and do some simple exercises. Thanks to this, your intervertebral disc will be able to get back to its natural position and will be better nourished. We should take such breaks approximately every 1 hour of sitting, and this break should not be shorter than 5 minutes. A good way that always works is to put the coffee machine in the farthest corner of the office, so you need to walk. We should also remember that when it is not necessary to sit, it's better to stand up and walk. So, for example, when you can, pick up the phone while you are standing. Even if you are sitting right now, this movie has been already several minutes long, so you should get up and take a few steps. And I'm also going for a walk. That is all I wanted to tell you today. I hope that in this movie you found some interesting information on lumbar disc herniation, that you know how damage occurs while you are sitting and how to counteract it. Feel free to subscribe to the channel, and if you like the video, please give me a thumb up and leave a comment. Thanks for watching, and bye. As usual, all the links to the scientific publications that I used can be found in the description of the movie.